Hello everyone and welcome to We Meet at Digital Days. My name is Lisa Richter and I will moderate this presentation. We are very pleased that you took the time to participate in our virtual conference. The topic of this presentation is secondary site compensation for isolated power supplies. Our speaker is Carlo Lombardi from our partner Microchip Technology. He will hold a presentation and will answer your questions. Before we start, I would like to point out one thing. You will be muted during the presentation. This means that you cannot ask questions via microphone during the presentation. Nevertheless, you have the opportunity to ask questions during the presentation at any time via the chat function. You will find the chat function in the control panel. This presentation will be about 30 minutes long, and the chat questions will be answered in a Q&A session following the webinar. There are 5 to 10 minutes scheduled for this. If you are unable to answer all of your questions within this time, we will answer them via email afterwards. If you still have any other questions left, just mail us at exhibition@we-online.com. We will try to answer all of your questions promptly. So at the end of the presentation, you will be asked to participate in a feedback survey. We would be pleased if you take the time to fill out a survey and help us to improve our event. You'll receive the link to the presentation in the next few days, and the recording will be available at our website shortly. So now I will hand over to our speaker, and I wish you an exciting presentation.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this short seminar about secondary site compensation. My name is Carlo Lombardi and I am a field application engineer based in the Italian office working at Microchip. So the agenda for today, as we said, we are going to talk about secondary site compensation. So we will see why in some application, not all, it makes sense to control our flyback power supply from the secondary side. We will see which are the challenges that we will have doing secondary side compensation. And then I will present a new device that Microchip recently released that can be used for controlling a flyback from the secondary side. This done, I will show you a techniques that Microchip put in place to transfer PWM signal from the secondary side to the primary side. And at the end, I will show you a demo board based on this new device. And finally, a real application where we implemented secondary side compensation for an interior lighting application where PFC has also been implemented. Okay, so let's start why secondary side compensation. This is the typical block diagram of a flyback converter where we can see that the control of the flyback is placed on the primary side. In some cases, there is a measure of the output voltage using a kind of Zener or voltage reference. The error compared to the output voltage is transferred at the primary side, and then the controller on the primary side takes care of controlling our flyback. This is a solution that in most of the case is the right one. If you just need an output voltage, this is the right solution, but there are some applications where you may need more flexibility. In this case, the output voltage is determined by a Zener at the output, so there is no possibility to change it runtime. There is an optocoupler that is used to transfer the error signal from the secondary side to the primary side. In some cases, you may have the drawback of this solution that optocoupler working in linear mode are subject to aging, so the behavior of your circuit may change a little bit in the time. And above all, you have not, with this solution, the possibility to implement power factor correction. Also, shutdown is not always possible to be implemented. Okay, let's see some application where actually a primary control flyback may not be used. One of them is USB power delivery. That is the new standard to charge devices, telephone, tablet, PC. This new standard, differently from the previous one, from USB 2.0, allows to charge our devices after a negotiation with voltages that are different from 5 volt. We can reach up to 20 volt, if I'm not wrong, the very last standard up to 45 volt, with power capability up to 100 watt. Okay? So in this case, we need to be able to control the output voltage and to change runtime, the output voltage, according to the negotiation between the power supply and the device itself. Another application where we need more flexibility are, for example, LED driver. In LED driver, most of the time we don't know the load, so we don't know which voltage will be needed to drive LEDs. We need a precise current regulation. If the application is above 25 watt, we also need PFC. And typically, we also need to be able to put our circuit in power down when the light is off. But at the same time, our circuit need to be active because, for example, there is some communication that are used to turn on the light again. Okay, so here is a block diagram where it is shown how to control a flyback controller from the secondary side. So basically we have a PWM controller on the secondary side that measure the output voltage or the output current, it depends from the application, and generate a PWM that will be used to directly drive the flyback. In this case, because we need insulation, the PWM need to be insulated, so needs to be transferred at the input, when there will be some kind of MOSFET driver that will take care to drive the flyback. Okay, typically in this kind of application on the secondary side controller, we don't just have an analog circuit, but typically we have something more intelligent, typically a microcontroller. Okay, so in this case, if we want to use a simple and cheap microcontroller, we need a dedicated family of microcontroller that have some peripheral dedicated to power control. Microchip released in the past and is in production a family of microcontroller, 8-bit microcontroller, so I would say quite cheap devices, where we have a set of peripheral that are dedicated to power supply. So in this case, we have operational amplifier, we have comparator, we have PWM modulator that can be configured by the MCU itself, and once configured are able to drive our power topology without the need of further CPU intervention. This is a very flexible solution that can be implemented thanks to the fact that we have specialized analog peripheral, or actually a mix of analog and digital peripheral, that are core independent. Core independent means that once configured, they can run alone without the MCU. Okay, so here is just a brochure that, according to the different microcontroller family, highlights which are the peripheral available. So in our case, where we need to drive a power supply, this family, PIC16F17, as you can see, has high-speed comparator, as operational amplifier, as slope compensation peripheral, typically used for current mode or to create a PWM modulator. It has 10-bit PWMs, and so on. So combining this peripheral, we can implement a PWM controller. Some other functionalities that may be needed on more advanced application are power factor correction. So basically, in this case, we need that the input current has the same shape of the grid, so a sinusoidal current. And typically, this depends from the power and from your application. In case of LEDs, for example, the limit for PFC is 25. Some additional features that may be implemented with secondary side control are soft start, or for example, in the case of USB power delivery, we need to generate controlled transition from one voltage to the other. So basically, we generate a voltage ramp. Lastly, also EMI is typically important for power supply switching application. So we can easily enable some spread spectrum frequency modulating our PWM, and this allows to reduce a little bit the noise above all on the conducted emissions. Okay, protection are also important. Having a controller that measures directly the output voltage and the output current is quite easy at this point to put in place protection with accurate value, so we avoid the risk of over intervention or under intervention of our circuit. So we can trim our intervention according to our needs. Okay, as it always happens in engineering, when we discuss about a solution, there are always some advantages, but also some challenges and some drawbacks. So also in this case, this will happen. So which are the challenges? Okay, we want to control a circuit with a secondary side controller that at the beginning is unpowered. So this is a problem because the controller is not up and running. And at the same time, the voltage coming from the power supply needs to be controlled by the controller itself. Okay? So at this point, we need to find a mechanism that at startup takes power directly from the grid, from the primary side, and start our circuit. So during this phase, taking current directly from the grid will bring to some power dissipation. Another challenge is low power and sleep, because again, if I'm going to stop the power supply, the secondary controller may not be supplied anymore. Okay, this is actually not a big problem, but also we need to cross the insulation with the PWM signal that need to be transferred from the secondary to the primary side. So let's see now this new circuit recently released by Microchip called MCP1012 that is an auxiliary controller for flyback circuit to be used on primary side. Okay, so the same block diagram we saw before. So we have here our secondary side controller, but in this case the PWM is transferred, let's say, from the secondary to the primary, and then with this circuit that is basically a MOSFET driver with some advanced feature. Okay, so first of all, let's see how it works. At startup, MCP1012 takes high voltage power directly from the main, so from the rectified grid. Okay, in order to start up the flyback and start to generate some voltage on the secondary side, this auxiliary controller start to send burst of pulses to the gate, where the on time is limited by the current. So we have a comparator that when the current on the primary side reaches a specific threshold, turns off the PWM and keep it off for 21 microseconds. Okay, so at this point, the secondary side start to be supplied, so it can start and take control of the output, generating a PWM that will be sent to the primary. During normal operation, the current limit on the primary is still in place with a different threshold, and this allows to protect our circuit against an overcurrent. Again, if the current goes above a specific threshold, the on time is terminated. Of course, we have also under and over voltage lockout to protect our circuit. And finally, we have a way to put the circuit in sleep mode to reduce the input power. Okay, so let's see now some more details about this auxiliary controller. So, as I said, it can take the power directly from the grid. So we have an input voltage up to 500 volt maximum, and actually 700 volt transient. This is an high voltage regulator that generates a voltage of around 11 volt that are sent on an external pin, but also used for the bias of internal circuit. We have then a MOSFET driver that is used to pulse the MOS of the flyback. And then we have this mechanism for the startup. So we have a low frequency oscillator that generates startup pulses that at the beginning, through these MUX, are sent directly to the gate. Okay? Okay, pulses are sent to the gate and we have a comparator to limit the current. So as soon as the current triggers the comparator, the gate is turned off. Okay, then we have over voltage and under voltage circuit. And once the startup is terminated, when VDD goes above around 11.5 volt, the multiplexer select the pulses, the PWM coming from the secondary. Okay. As I said before, there is the possibility to put this circuit in idle mode, and this can be done from the secondary side, sending a train of 5 pulses at 500 kHz. Okay? So, if we put in sleep the device, of course, we need a way to go back to normal functioning. Okay? So, if pulses are not received from the secondary for more than 260 microseconds, MCP1012 goes back to startup. This feature also prevents the situation where the secondary side controller, for any reason, stop to work. So in this case, the system is going to start up, okay, to recover the normal behavior. If the VDD on the 11 volt pin goes below the under voltage threshold, again, this means that the secondary side in some way lost the control of our system, and again, startup is started, is recovering. Okay. What happens if we put the device in sleep? Okay. If we restart to send PWM from the secondary, the normal behavior recover and we exit from sleep. We can send a single pulse, so in this case the startup will be activated again, or eventually if the under voltage pin is going below the under voltage, startup is activated again. So all these features allows the circuit to work in a safe way and avoid any situation where the secondary side is off and the primary controller is waiting for something from the secondary side. Okay, let's see now how this circuit is used inside a flyback circuit. So we have our secondary controller, in this case a voltage regulator. It generates PWM and send them to the MCP. Let's see now which is the sequencing. So at the beginning, we turn on the grid and MCP start taking power directly from the grid. So we have in this phase, let's say high power dissipation. So at this point, train or burst of pulses are sent to the MOSFET. So we start to drive the flyback with a constant of time and Ton limited by the current sense. So at this point, the flyback start to be live, and we start to get some voltage both at the output, so we start to supply our secondary circuit, but at the same time, using an auxiliary circuit at the primary, we also start to send some power to MCB 1012. Okay. At this point, the secondary side start to it turns on, start to generate pulses that in this situation are not yet passed to the MOSFET. As soon as the auxiliary voltage is high enough, so in the range of 11.5 volt, the power taken from the grid is turned off, so we reduce dramatically power dissipation, and pulses from the secondary start to be sent directly to the gate. In this case, the current threshold is increased in order to protect the circuit only in case of overcurrent. Okay, so this is the startup sequence of this implementation. Here is a real example of waveform. So here the yellow are the pulses sent to the gate, and the purple one is the voltage sent to the auxiliary pin. So we are on the primary side of our flyback. If we expand the gate voltage, you can see that at the beginning, so at startup, we have some pulses that with further expansion shows that every one of these bursts is made by 16 pulses of PWM. Once the auxiliary voltage increase above 11.5, at this point we pass the control to the secondary controller, and if we expand the gate voltage in this region, you see that it is a continuous pulse PWM. Okay, as I said before, one of the challenges we have with this implementation is that we need to transfer pulses from the secondary side to the primary side. Microchip put in place these techniques called in-the-flux, that basically is a technique that allows to transfer pulses using the same transformer used for power. So basically we are using the flyback transformer to transfer the PWM from the secondary to the primary. So here is the transformer where we have primary and secondary for the power. So it is our flyback transformer. And the red line inside the transformer are the power flux path of the magnetic field that from the central leg of the core goes equally in the two side legs. Okay. Then at this point, we add two additional windings called signal primary and signal secondary. Every signal winding is actually made by two windings, one on the left and one on the right leg of the transformer, that if we wind in the right way, these windings are not affected by the field, magnetic field generated by the power path. Okay, if they are in opposite phase compared to the field, the two voltage aligns. Okay, so at this point we do the same for a secondary signal winding. At this point, driving the secondary signal, we generate the blue magnetic path that allows us to transfer the PWM from the primary to the secondary, or eventually not only a PWM, but eventually also some communication signal if needed. Okay. What is available to test the solution? This one is a 15 watt demo board based of course on NCP 1012 where the secondary side control has been implemented. Being a demo board and let's say with didactic purposes, of course we have not optimized the number of components, but we split different functions on different components to highlight which is the architecture of this solution. So we have the MCP driving the flyback as we described up to now. On the secondary side, we have a general purpose MCU that is driving a PWM controller that at this point we generate the PWM to be sent to the primary. Okay? In this case, the application allows to generate output voltages from 3 to 5 volt, roughly, and using a power switch, we can enable two different loads. Using a microcontroller, of course, we have the option of communication. So in this case, we also implemented a GUI that runs on the PC that allows to change the output voltage to supervise the circuit. And okay, so this is a demo board that allows to become confident with this kind of solution. Here on the other end is a different solution where we implemented a real application for LED drive. So this is the board we build. The input voltage is a kind of extended voltage from 190 to 254. This was a customer requirement. Output power is 50 watt, and from this power you can see that power factor correction will be needed, because for lighting application we need power factor above 25 watt. Okay, LED current is fixed to 350. And because it is an internal lighting application to reduce A strain due to the dimming, we choose a quite high frequency for the dimming, so 1 kHz. Of course, dimming range is between 0 to 100%, and efficiency is in the range of 87%. Not very high, but this is the typical efficiency that you can get when you use a traditional flyback converter. As I said, PFC is needed, and properly controlling the PWM that drives the flyback, we can get a total harmonic distortion below 2%. Okay, insulation is 4 kHz, and then we have an additional interface. It is this one here, where you can plug different communication transceiver. Okay, so the design of course is based on MCP 1012. The secondary side is actually implemented with a single device. It is a 8-bit microcontroller where we have all the analog and digital peripheral needed to implement controllers. So first of all we need a voltage controller that control the output voltage of our circuit. And this controller is going to send the PWM to the primary side. This is made combining some analog and digital peripheral that I will show in more details later on. This controller also takes care of the PFC. Actually, in a flyback working in discontinuous mode, PFC is quite simple because you automatically get sinusoidal current if you drive your PFC with a constant on time, at least for one grid cycle. Okay, then because we have LEDs, we need to also regulate the current inside LEDs. And in this case, we implemented a linear regulator. Again, the linear regulator is completely controlled, combining analog and digital peripherals on the microcontroller. Okay. Okay, I already said this, but I want to highlight again that once the peripherals are configured, they don't need the MCU anymore. So the MCU basically is free for other stuff, communication, for example, housekeeping, and so on. Here is the architecture. So we have our flyback, then we have our LED string, that in this case was a string of around 150 volt. Because the output of a PFC is affected by definition by ripple at 100 Hz, in order to regulate the current inside the LED, we need to add an additional regulator, and we implemented a series regulator. Because this is a series regulator, is power dissipative, so in order to reduce power dissipation, we need to keep the voltage here as low as possible. So the regulation on this circuit is done to keeping here in the range of 2-3 volts. Okay. In order to keep the voltage here at 2-3 volts, we have an output voltage regulator that drives the PWM, sending that drives the flyback, sorry, sending the right PWM. All these blocks are implemented inside the microcontroller. Okay, here are some more details. So you can see that for the current regulator, we measure the current using a shunt, send the current to an operational amplifier that on the other side receive a set point using a D2A, and this circuit will drive the MOSFET in a way that the current here will be the same of the value set on the set point. At this point, modulating the set point with a dimming frequency of 1 kHz, we can easily turn on and off our LED. Here it is the sensing point for the voltage. Again, it goes to an error amplifier that receives a reference with a DAC. Then combining digital and analog peripheral, we create a PWM modulator. And at this point, using optocoupler, we send the PWM to the primary. Going a little bit in more details, here is the peripheral implementation of both controllers. So the first one, the voltage regulator, here you have the voltage sensed on the current regulator, here is the reference, 2-3 volts, here is the compensation network to keep the loop stable, and here is the error. Okay, the error is sent to a comparator on one side. On the other side of the comparator, we have a ramp generator that allows to generate here a PWM proportional to the error value. Okay? Then combining some additional peripheral and some additional PWM, we can also set the minimum duty cycle and the maximum duty cycle. This signal sent to a flip-flop will generate the PWM. This is not enough. When you have a flyback, if you disconnect the load, of if you have no load at all, there is high risk that the output voltage goes too high and damage your circuit. So using an additional comparator with another D2A, we set a voltage threshold that, in case it is triggered, goes to this flip-flop, immediately disabling the output PWM. All these blocks in blue are internal peripheral, all the blue line are internal connection. So you see that with this kind of microcontroller, using core independent peripheral, we can create a kind of super peripheral that fits the need of our application. For the current controller, here we sense the current. Here on the other input of the operational amplifier, we have our reference. Here is the compensation network. In this case, the output of the operational amplifier goes directly to the MOSFET, driving it in a linear way to keep the current at the wanted value. These blocks here are the way we used to generate the reference. We have a D2A reference on 10 bit, so with quite high resolution, and this is buffered using an op-amp and a resistor. On the other end, this peripheral, that is basically a flip-flop, has the important feature that we can set its output either to high impedance or to zero. So driving the flip-flop with a 1 kHz PWM with a proper duty cycle, we can have in this point, as a reference for the operational amplifier, a signal that when on has the value of the current we want on LEDs, when it's off, LED are off. So again, we have a kind of dimming engine that once we have set the duty cycle of this PWM, automatically drive our current generator. Okay, so this is the end of my presentation. I hope it will be useful for your future application. And now, if you have any question, I'm here to answer. Thank you all.
Yes, thank you very much, Carlo, for your presentation. Like you already said, we would like to turn our attention now to your questions. So maybe we will start with a first question. In a secondary side controlled power supply, what happens if the secondary loses the control of the output voltage?
Okay, yes. This is the main concern we may have with this kind of circuit. Okay, potentially if the secondary side lose the control, we don't know what may happen. Actually, with the feature implemented inside the auxiliary controller MCP1012, that always try to restart our circuit if it doesn't receive the PWM, our application in some way is always under control. Of course, we can also add additional protection and, let's say, tricks on the secondary controller to avoid this kind of situation. I hope I answered to the question.
Sounds good. Let's have a look to the next question. Is PFC always needed in secondary side controlled power supply?
No, actually, the answer depends from the application. There is a standard that specifies when PFC is needed, but basically, let's say in standard application or not lighting application, PFC is required above 75 watts. In case of lighting, the standard is more stringent, and in this case, PFC is needed above 25 watts. If you are below, there is no need to implement PFC. Okay, are you going to read the question or I will?
Yes. I think I can read it. This type of control doesn't perform peak current control as normal USCC 38045, right? It's a simple direct duty circle control.
Yes, correct. So peak current control is only implemented as startup to limit the current inside the transformer. But once the secondary side takes control, there is no more peak current mode. In this situation, the comparator is only used to protect your flyback, your primary, from overcurrent. So if your current is below the threshold, nothing will happen.
Okay, great. So thank you very much, Carlo, for your time. That was a great presentation, and thank you for the Q&A session now. If there are any questions left, we will answer them via email afterwards. So Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed our presentation. The next topic is connector temperature rise and derating. And this presentation starts at 2 p.m. So hopefully see you there and enjoy our digital days. Goodbye.
Thank you for attending. Bye.